these two men are Nigel Lewin. He's an English guy. And Raghavan Raman. Raghi Raman. Now, Raghi Raman was a supporter of the Tamil Tigers. He also told me that he thought AIDS was man-made. He explained why he thought that. Raghi Raman guarded me in 2011 when I was locked up illegally because of my support of Sri Lanka against the Tamil Tigers, of which he was a supporter. He makes it clear in another interview that I recorded and I've already posted. However, this is the man who has been injecting me with poisons for more than 10 years. When I asked him if he's MI5, because he's behaving like an MI5 guy, he said, "I wish." I said, "Why? Does it pay well?" He said, "I'd imagine so." He also didn't tell me that he's the chairman of the arch. Not only did he not tell me, but when I asked him, he said, "No, the arch is a French, supposedly Catholic charity, and it was founded by a Frenchman called Jean Billier, and this man was being lined up, Jean Billier was being lined up for a sainthood and Nobel Peace Prize, but then he died and it emerged that he was sexually molesting his female staff." Now, in this next segment, which I'm going to play now, Nigel Lewin was trying to argue the case for starting me on 3 monthly injections of what he called Trinza, which is an extra long-acting drug, antipsychotic drug, dopamine-blocking drug, made by Janssen. And he was trying to convince me to have 3 monthly injections, but 3 times the dose. And it so happens that the psychiatrist, Mark Taylor, and the director of psychiatry, Balaji, have written joint paper promoting these 3 monthly paliperidone injections. And it's patently obvious in all these interviews that I've got a lot of them, I've only uploaded a few, it's patently obvious I'm not mentally ill. So he's hiding behind the psychiatrist, but he doesn't tell them the truth. He doesn't tell the truth, full stop. Now, Nigel Lewin, as I said, started injecting me about 2011. This is recorded in September 2019. Around that time, he left his diary behind in my house. So I've had a chance to look at what he does. And what he does is drive around in a government car injecting people with dopamine-blocking poisons. Even though it was obvious that I was being poisoned because I couldn't talk properly, I was drooling all over my clothes. In addition to sterilizing me, I put on a whole lot of weight. And these people had no right whatsoever to be judging my sanity. So he's hiding behind the doctor, Dr. Joseph. Anup Joseph was given a job in Bundaberg Bundaberg Hospital, which had Jayant Patel, employed a surgeon who didn't know his limits to kill patients. They called him Dr. Death. Well, Arnold Joseph was part of the same racket. They enter Australia, supposedly for a rural doctor's program at the Bundaberg Hospital, and then they move down to Brisbane or move somewhere else. They get paid Ghazala Watt. Ghazala Watt was a Pakistani woman that Lewin called her Dr. Watts. She wasn't Watts, she was Watt. And she's from Pakistan, had never heard of the Belt and Road Initiative, even though it was the biggest development project in Pakistan. She also asked me what's wrong with supporting the Tamil Tigers. She's got a Getty, she had a Getty photograph of her on her Facebook. She had a lot of money. This guy, Lewin, travels around the world. And he laughed at the fact that I don't get paid for any of my work. He said, most people make more money than you, and laughed. It's not funny. As it turned out, Raghavan is a person who refused to reject me. Because he could see, because it's very obvious, that he was killing me. He also listened to my music and read some of my books online. And he said that you can recognize that what I'm writing is the truth. I'll let you listen to Lewin as I explain about the corruption, but you can see what his response is.
I am, as you know, taking legal action against the hospital.
Sure.
But I'm also reporting the hospital for serious corruption.
Yep.
Right? Mm-hmm. Let me outline the corruption.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep.
Now you, these injections that you get,
yep,
that you bring around,
yes,
are dispensed by the Buranda Kempro.
That's correct, yeah.
Right?
Yes.
It's owned by Fijian Indian,
yeah,
by the name of Samuel Chan.
Yeah, yeah,
you know him, do you?
Well, he used to work there, but he doesn't now.
He still owns it.
No, no, he owns it. He doesn't work there anymore. Got a number of pharmacists, I think he's building this.
Now he bought the Buranda Kempro.
From Ping?
From?
A Chinese gentleman, Ping, I think he's Chinese.
He bought it from Terry White.
Kind of. Yeah. But it was still Terry White's.
What do you mean, kind of?
Well, it was still Terry White's. It was somebody else before him that was. They owned it, and then he bought him out, and it was Terry White's at the time, and then they changed the name to Ken Crowe.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Terry White was the chairman of the board of directors of the PA hospital.
Was he on the board?
Mm-hmm. He was not on the board,
mm-hmm,
he was the chairman of the board.
Really?
Now, would you regard that as a conflict of interest?
I think the original contract they had with Ken Fryer was with a guy prior to Terry White. So I think it was just carried on as a, as long as he declared his interest, I don't think it's necessarily a conflict. Because the money that they'd given them, like for dispensing all of the medications for Metro South, that was a contract that was, as far as I'm aware, that contract was all well before Terry White took over that chemist.
You don't think there's a conflict of interest?
Well, if he declares it as a chair, you don't have to necessarily, unless they're talking about, you can just declare your conflict of interest as a chairperson or on the board. You don't have to absent yourself from the board.
Now, what do you think of Balaji Motamarri and Mark Taylor accepting fees and hospitality from Janssen today?
That's for them to discuss. That's for them to decide whether or not that's acceptable for them. I don't know if they have, then...
Well, I don't think it's acceptable.
No, well, that's your opinion. Obviously, you know, there's a whole variety of different opinions around that.
So they are promoting injectable therefore injections, and they're getting paid bribes.
Well, there's
by the company.
There's lots of doctors that work for, that still have public health practices and work for pharmaceutical companies.
And I know, and that's called corruption.
All over the world, yeah.
It's called corruption.
We get them coming out from the UK or something.
I know.
Promoting a particular
company. I know. I know you did, and that's what I call corruption.
Yeah, there was a big thing. I mean, it's interesting because when I worked in the UK many years ago, and even recently, like back in 2007, there was a ban on medication companies bringing sandwiches and all those things and doing drug rep talks to nurses because of the risk of trying to give them inducements to have dinner and all that sort of stuff. But yeah, so that was frowned on then. But it seems to me that a lot of those things have kind of changed now, and people have gone back to their old ways, really.
Do you think that's a problem?
I think if you're promoting a particular drug and you're using that drug solely, and you're not...
Solely?
Well, you're not looking at the research and efficacy of particular medications and making a value judgment on each individual person, then I think it can be an issue. But you know, a lot of those injectables have very similar constitutions in terms of, like, risperidone and Trinza and paliperidone. They're all made by Janssen. They're all the same.
I know.
And risperidone was the first one that came out, and then paliperidone and now Trinza, which is a 3-month injection.
And these drugs.
I mean, that's why I said to you, I think really, you know, like, to avoid a lot of that, the monthly injections, and because the Trinza is a sustained release over a 3-month period, I think it has less side effects. So, I did say to you that I thought that actually, in terms of if you're going to have to stay on it, if the doctors believe you have to stay on injectables, then, you know, for you, I think it would have less side effects.
These doctors are junior to me. They know less about psychiatry than I do. They know less about medicine, and they know less about the brain.
Well, that may well be the case, because you're a very knowledgeable chap, and that's not just promotion, I know you're a very intelligent and academic.
I'm not an academic, I'm a clinician.
Well,
I have a background as a clinician.
I know, but you publish lots of research papers, which...
They're not research papers.
No.
They're books.
All right, books.
I have not published any research papers.
Okay. Well, but you've researched what you've published.
researched the information before I published books.
Well, that's what happened.
That are about history and about psychiatry and about politics and about corruption. I've written about eugenics and scientific racism. I've written about music and the brain. This is a book that I wrote back in 2003.
Yeah, good. I couldn't move properly. I feel fine. Talking really slowly.
Yeah, it's a fascinating area, music and the brain.
This is my original theoretical work on music and the brain. This is a little bit of it. All of these folders on music and the brain. A little snuggy.
It's strange, you know.
The first time I went to see Anup Jolda, who had previously, back in 2016, sent a man called, a Scottish man called, what's his name? Stephen Crawford. Yeah, a Scottish guy called Steve Crawford. And this man had previously come in 2013 with a woman called Dodd Densley. That was her surname. And police, and they abducted me. And this guy has been doing it over and over again, Steve Crawford, who was among the 150 or so Facebook friends that Nigel Lewin has. I presented some evidence against Steve Crawford, which I haven't posted online yet, but I'm going to. And I showed this folder that Nigel Lewin is looking at. I showed it to Anup Jolda, who is, he said, a nominal Catholic from Kerala. So happens the Bargis family are also Indian Catholics from Kerala, even though they came to Australia during the White Australia policy, from Kenya, where their father was a lecturer in history who whitewashed the genocide of Aboriginal people. Wanted to get a black guy to do it. People are so devious. So devious. And when I showed Anup Jolda, who's 20 years junior to me and qualified, unlike me, I was graduated at the University of Queensland after being the top academic student in Church of England Grammar School, as well as being a scholarship-winning student, scholarship and multiple prize-winning student at Trinity College in Sri Lanka. This idiot, Anup Jolda, has one paper that he wrote, which is a joint paper, and he was on using CAT scans to record and monitor weight gain. CAT scans of the abdomen to measure weight gain on patients who are on Eli Lilly's drug, Zyprexa. Eli Lilly is the company, because it's Lilly now, that bought the rights to manufacture LSD from a Swiss company called Sandoz. And LSD was supplied by Eli Lilly to the CIA for the MK programs. The MK program also included Britain and Australia, which a lot of people don't know about. I know this because the conversation, because of the conversations that I had with a psychologist called Conway. Is his first name? You'll come to me. Yeah, Conway was a psychologist at St. Vincent's Hospital in Melbourne. And he admitted that he injected himself with LSD. And I also know from Melbourne that LSD that was being sold in Melbourne had the logo, the streets of LSD had the logo of Disney. In addition, Eli Lilly are the company that came out with the first SSRI drugs. LSD also affects serotonin. The first SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. That's the class of drugs, so SSRI drugs. I remember his name, it's Ronald Conway. And Ronald Conway was, his obituary when he died was written by Tony Abbott. Now, as I said, Eli Lilly produced Prozac and I identified in 1997 as a key theme of my book, Psychiatric Tales and Words About Life, that information about the pineal was being suppressed. And the people who were suppressing it started being suppressed long ago, but even more suppressed when they were marketing Prozac. And the reason is simple. Serotonin is concentrated in the pineal, where it's converted to melatonin. And the information about the pineal organ was suppressed because they didn't want people to know about the metabolism of serotonin and melatonin. And I identified this, what is actually a conspiracy of silence, you could say, back in 1995, 1996. And that is a key factor in what's going on. The other thing is I showed this guy, Anup Joseph, who told me he had discussed me with his boss, who I thought was Balaji Motamarri, but he said Kare, Manan Kare. Both Kare and Joseph got very angry when I called them on their mobile phones. I got their mobile phone numbers from the diary of Nigel Lewin that he had left behind in my house in 2019. So again, you can hear this yourself. Anup Joseph getting angry, I've got it posted. And Anup Joseph started off saying, I just got a thing to ask you. How did you get my number? I didn't answer him. He got angry that quickly. Are you hearing me? Where did you get my number? That's what he was like. I know a lot about abusive people, having lived here for a long time, having a very abusive father and sister. And they're the people who put me into the psychiatric system, along with my sister's boyfriend, Robert Percy, and my father's best friend, Chevran Bakumaru Kulasinghe, who was the surgical boss of the Tamil Tigers. My father was a medical boss of the Tamil tigers. My father is not Tamil. But Raghavan is. He's an Indian Tamil. And as I said, Raghavan refused to inject me. But this turd was trying to get me to have 3 monthly injections at 3 times the dose, which happened to be what his bosses, who were Balaji, Motamarri and Mark Taylor, that's another link of great importance to the narrative, because Mark Taylor was in Melbourne. He's an English guy, like Nigel Lewin is. And he took over, locking me up and torturing me chemically from Kim Jenkins, who's also English, and her registrar, Tejpal Singh, who's Indian. My father wrote a letter, which I have a copy of, where he thanked them effusively for the help that they had given him. That was the help for locking me up and injecting me when I came up with a peace plan for Sri Lanka, for peace plan for Timor. I was opposed to Australian troops being sent there in 1999. So I was referred into the system by a Jewish doctor that I was doing sessions for by the name of Abraham Mass. He reported that I had SAD. SAD stands for SAD, of course, and seasonal affective disorder, and also schizoaffective disorder. So Abraham Mass said that I had schizoaffective disorder. Of course I didn't have it. And at the time I was living in a house that I was renting from a Jewish real estate agent called Chaim Sharp. And the house was owned by another Jewish guy whose name was Avi Javorowski. He was a chemist and he happens to be on the list of names of people who work for the Burnett Institute, which I've written about and been researching for more than 25 years now because of its involvement in genocide of black people. What's more, the Murdoch children's, supposedly children's genetic research institute, which is on the top floor of Melbourne's Royal Children's Hospital. The boss of it was Scandinavian. I spoke to him many years ago to ask him about the tests that they were doing, the research they were doing, looking for a schizophrenia gene in the blood of Bantu African adults. Bantu was black people in South Africa. Meanwhile, as you can see, he didn't think there was any conflict of interest with Terry White building his franchise by being the chemist on the other side of the road, the BA hospital. And this conflict of interest is patently obvious. And the other, when I showed Anup Joseph this folder of my, one of many folders of my work on music and the brain, he said, "I'm not really a music person." You didn't want to look at it. Manan Kare also wouldn't speak to me. I still haven't spoken to him. Although I have rung him a few times. I did actually speak to him initially because he didn't expect the call. But he got angry as well. These people are so damn arrogant. Anup Joseph told me that he wouldn't have a problem with diagnosing a neurologist with mental illness. Absolutely shocking. I asked him about human rights abuses. He didn't think there were any in psychiatry. And then another of the Indian crooks that they put me under, I called Tarun Segal. I asked him if he thought AIDS was man-made. And he said, I'd be naive to answer that. Naive to answer it. Pretty obviously he knew that he was. I'm tendering this as evidence against these people because they are guilty of absolutely monstrous human rights abuses and collusion in genocide, because that's what I was writing about in 2001. Eugenics and genocide in the modern world. There was a 600-page book which they have not acknowledged at all at the BA hospital. In their framing documents. Their framing documents, including the MHRT reports, which continued repeating a false narrative about me. Oh no.
My husband, who's had a stroke and has got no verbal speech, or very little verbal speech apart from that sort of thing. He can actually, he can sing words, but he can't speak them. So he can sing happy birthday, or he can sing a song, but he can't form the language to.
I knew that years and years ago. I have mentioned it in my books. These people are not looking for evidence of sanity, they are only looking for evidence of insanity. And if they don't have any evidence of insanity, they make it up. So I was taken off treatment authority, which was illegal. But they didn't intend to do that. When they locked me up the last time, they tried to get me put under another guy, another Indian guy called Nakul Parasha. And then they changed it to two Jewish psychiatrists, women. I think they're Jewish, that's what another patient told me. It was Valerie Spivak and Karen Fryer. And Karen Pryor consulted with Arnab Joseph, and they took me off the treatment authority. But prior to that, I'd been seen a couple of times by another psychiatrist. His name was Paul Northway. And Paul Northway wanted to take me off the treatment authority because, for one thing, it was illegal. I wasn't being treated, and I wasn't showing signs of mental illness. And the people who contacted him and asked him to keep me on the treatment authority were the police. And the reason was that they planned on doing this enforcement order for a public health risk that they alleged my garden and my plants posed. With this justification, they completely destroyed my business. My garden, they bulldozed it, bulldozed all my frog ponds, stole my Buddha statue, or bulldozed it as well.